ready? Good afternoon. Welcome to everybody. Thank you, Mr. McPherson and Dr. Corcoran for preparing this packet for us. We will do roll call. We'll start with Mr. Butler, please.
Philip Butler.
Vicki Alston. Kimberly McMichael.
Paula Rakestraw.
Vicki McKinney.
Bob Wyatt.
Thank you. This time, can I please have a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Sorry, I forgot to turn my microphone on.
I did too.
So, good afternoon, Madam Chair, board members, and Dr. Stover. As you know, at our last board meeting, each of you received a hard copy of the policy packet that you see in front of you on the screen. And as you know, these were revisions that we had asked for in response to Senate Bill 49, Parents' Bill of Rights. As you know, the Senate Bill 49 enumerates the rights of parents to direct the upbringing, the education, the health care, and mental health of minor children. And it has required that school districts across the state of North Carolina respond and adjust to this piece of legislation. In turn, the State Board of Education has sent recommendations for revisions of some of the existing policies that you've had the packet and been able to read, hopefully, in this time. We will meet the deadline because my goal is for us to hear and talk about, as we listen to Mr. McPherson's presentation today, but also then to be able to bring these board policies back to you in December, allow you to vote on those, and then we will have met that January 1st deadline that we've been required to meet to having had approved these policies. You have had some time for these policies in your possession, and I imagine that some of you have some questions. However, I do believe that most of your questions are going to be answered in this presentation by Mr. McPherson today. I do also want to point out that if you look at the grid that is at the very beginning of this packet, you'll see that most of these are required. So even though sometimes we get that recommendation of recommended, highly recommended, or required, most of what you're seeing in this packet, short of a few things, are required of us. So that's part of today's discussion, of course. As I mentioned in my email to all of you last week, the district team and other stakeholders will be looking to how to interpret and respond to the requirements, which may take the form of our creating additional local policies or regulations. So I anticipate that as our team, as the district team, as different stakeholders that help advise and talk with us, that when we do this, that there may be some additional policies or regulation, local policies that we create. And as always, I will always bring this back to our board policy committee. And of course, it will always run through that committee and then run through for approval. I did want to say, though, that this last month we've had two opportunities. Dr. Stover has pulled together the Parent Advisory Council, and they've already been very instrumental in helping us think about how do we respond to things like even the opt-in, the opt-out, right? And curriculum, questions about curriculum and materials. So I thought that was really great that we were able to already get their thoughts and processes about that. We've received some information guidance from NCDPI regarding the timeline. And I do want to point out, and you'll see this in Mr. McPherson's presentation, but that parent's guide to the Bill of Rights, their Bill of Rights really is not, we do not have to, or and probably will spend some time formulating and compiling this guide. But that is not required of us until the first day of school after January 1st, 2024. So I am confident that we'll have our guidebook by then and be able to do that. We've also been required to submit to DPI by September the 15th, 2024, an upload of our guide And some a link to our website where all of the information will be, you know, supposed to be posted. We've already been looking at other school districts' websites, what have their websites looked like, what is the best way to disseminate this information to parents and make it something that they can understand, but also, you know, it's a lot. There's just a lot to these policies and to sort of the implications that I think Mr. McPherson will do. Lastly, I'd like to say that once Mr. McPherson's presentation is complete today, I think most of those questions will be answered. But if you have any questions between now and the board meeting, because I anticipate that most of our time this afternoon will be with this presentation, you're welcome to email any of us on Dr. Stover's leadership team or others that you think might be able to help you with these questions. I'd like to thank Mr. McPherson for the presentation, and more importantly, I'd like to thank our staff too, because I think our staff and I think all of our administrators, our teachers, all the individuals really that are across our county, I know that their goal first and foremost is to make sure that parents have all the information they need to make great choices and decisions for their students. And I believe that Rockingham County Schools does that best. So anyway, I'll turn it over now to Mr. McPherson, and I'm going to pull up his presentation, and I'll allow him to get started.
Okay, board, administrators, everybody who's going to be impacted by the Parents' Bill of Rights. We're going to start off with, I love clip art and I love these nice posed photographs. I wish everybody in my office who's dealing with Parents' Bill of Rights looked as happy as these folks. I will tell you, they don't. But at the outset, let's make sure we're working here. Uh-oh. All right, step one, turn on the button. Okay, there we go. Here we go. The Parents' Bill of Rights is controversial. I will say was controversial because now we've got a whole lot of other controversies we're working at in state government. But I'm going to do my absolute best to play this as straight as humanly possible and to present you with both sides of most any given issues. In lots of ways, this is a movement. Parents' Bill of Rights has been introduced in 21 legislatures in the past 12 months. Several of them have passed. A lot of these are not necessarily new or unique ideas. A lot of them have been around for quite a while. And we're going to talk about a couple of those. But more importantly, it's an enumeration which makes it incredibly interesting, because it harkens back to the concept of the Bill of Rights and what a Bill of Rights are. And I think that language is really important when we start talking about why are we memorializing this in a statute. And I think there's a purposeful use of the term Bill of Rights to sort of harken back to a time where we wanted to regain or reclaim, you know, protections from the government. And that's what I think this is in a lot of ways. And so you're going to see a lot of summaries out there. More importantly, the thing I want you guys to know is you have lots of questions. I've also got lots of questions. I'm going to try to answer your questions as best I can. I'm going to try to answer y'all's questions as best I can, with the understanding that there are some items that I don't know the answer to, and we're not going to know the answer to until somebody sues, litigates, or the General Assembly decides to clarify. And so, without further ado, there's a theme, and it's about empowering parents for their kids' fundamental success. That is the concept. That's what we're after. We're after empowering parents, giving them back authority that they already possess to engage with their schools and engage with their children in such a way that they feel like they own the rights to guide their children's education. I will tell you that as a concept, I don't know that school folks, people who have lived and worked and taught in schools would ever say that parents didn't have that right or control, right? Like that was never really a question, but I think this is more of cementing a theme of parental control and authority to guide their students' education. That's the concept. There are four parts to the session law. First is the Parents' Bill of Rights. It creates 114A, which is the Parents' Bill of Rights. Part two is the parental guides and notifications. Part three is parental authorization for health care of minors. That's sort of a big deal. And the last is the effective date, part four. This was amended by the budget bill that passed, which is why you now have until January 1st to pass policies and get them in place. So those are the four parts of the Senate bill. All right. 14 top issues from Senate Bill 49. Need for lots of policies and procedures. Number one, first and foremost, in chronology, that's the first thing that has to happen before implementation. You guys have to set the rules, then your administrators have to be set out to do the business of those policies and procedures, okay? Next thing, need for training at all levels, particularly in the classroom, for how this actually works. So, step one, pass policies. Step two, train your people. Step three, first set of 10 parental rights, not school specific, codified in 114A. So, once again, I think there's an intentionality of using 10, Bill of Rights, verse 10. We amended it after that, but there were originally 10. Age-appropriate instruction in the K-4 context, a parent's guide for student achievement, notifications to parents in general versus individual. There's some overlap with what parents are required to be notified for under federal law and state law, and I'm going to try to point that out to you where we see it, where there's crossover of like, you already have to notify parents of this, but now under state law you have a state and federal requirement, or we're going to create a whole new requirement for when you have to notify parents of things. There's a little bit of that too. There's the opt-in requirement for protected information surveys, parents' request for information, and a local appeal process. This is going to be a huge area, number 10, because parent requests include parents' request for education records. Under federal law, we have 45 days to respond to that. Under this, arguably, at most, it's a month. I would say more likely 2 weeks. So when you're talking about producing education records, it abbreviates the timeline quite a bit. There's some implications for special ed litigation that I want to talk about when we get there, but just understand, like, there was a lobby that was pushing this that has a perverse incentive for pushing school boards to turn over records a lot faster than they were required to by federal law. The parental concern hearings before the state board hearing officer or lawsuit, that's a new one. The requirement to encourage students to involve parents, parent consent for healthcare treatment, and the annual reporting requirements to the state board. This is a timeline. By the 15th, boards are to adopt procedures for parental concern process required by 115C 76.60. By the first, boards to permit parents to begin using parental concern process. Also by January 1, the board is to adopt policies required by 115C 76.35. By the first day of school, this is the part, it's important, PSUs are to provide notice of health care services and means for parents to consent. Also, by the first day, of school. PSUs are provide a parent's guide for student achievement under 115C76.30. State Board of Education to begin receiving requests for parental concerns hearings is the 30th of January. And then September 15, 2024, PSUs submit a report to the state BOE. And then November 15, 2024, state BOE is required to submit a report to the General Assembly. That seems like a lot. That's a lot of deadlines. There's a lot of stuff moving on.
Mr. McPherson.
Yes, ma'am.
Could you clarify what the acronym PSU stands
for? Public School Unit.
Thank you. It's usually called LEA.
Well, there's a reason they're using Public School Unit. Thank you for bringing that up.
One more acronym into the mix.
It's to require charter schools. Charter schools and LEAs are referred to as PSUs. If they want to talk about just LEAs, local education authorities, they use LEA. Uh-huh. If they want to include charter schools, they use PSUs. Then if they want to refer to all schools, they say all schools operating in North Carolina. That includes your regional schools, private schools, home schools, all that other fun stuff. But, yeah.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you for asking the question. All right. Legal challenges. This is highly likely to be challenged. My understanding is there are multiple entities that are preparing similar lawsuits based on different elements of this legislation. ACLU has been thrown around. There are several Lambda Legal. Multiple organizations are looking at suing over this particular legislation. I will say one of the interesting things is going to be seeing how this actually plays out in practice, not necessarily the way it's written. So I don't necessarily think that it's discriminatory as written. I think that in implementation, schools can get themselves in trouble by following the intent of the General Assembly. I will show you when we get there what I mean. Because I actually don't think it's written discriminatory. I do think it's going to be the implementation that gets folks in trouble. That's why I think we have to be very cognizant, very aware of what we're doing and why we're doing it. We have this need for lots of policies and procedures, right? This is the reason we're having this at the 4 o'clock hour before board meetings, because everybody who is not normally on the policy committee is going to be hearing about policy issues. This is what we're talking about. And so these policies are to promote parental involvement and empowerment in the public school unit, to provide the link for parents to community services. Not that you guys don't already do that, by the way. They're to establish opportunities for parental involvement and development, implementation, and evaluation of family involvement programs. That means you have to have links on your website to get people to those services. It's not simply to say, hey, here are all these services. You have to be able to connect the dots for people. That's the idea. Once again, I already think you guys do a great job of that. Establish opportunities for parents to participate in the school advisory councils and in school volunteer programs and other activities. I think it's an interesting point. Post-COVID, there has been this big push to try to get parents back into schools, because for about a year and a half to 2 years, there was a thou shall not enter. We need to keep as many outsiders out as possible. Now it's we're trying to invite parents back in. I do see this as not necessarily an answer to that question, but I do see that as those two things can be done together, as in inviting people back into a place of learning to be involved with their kids, to volunteer to be a reader in your kid's class, to volunteer with the PTA or the local education foundation to help out. So the policies are to be developed in consultation with parents, teachers, administrators, and community partners. Interesting phrase. Is the board's regular policy development process sufficient to meet consultation requirement? I'm going to say yes, because I think by the deadline, you don't have much of a choice. If you want to consult for revisions after the fact, so be it. But I think as elected members, you do all sorts of consulting as possible. Y'all consult with parents, teachers, administrators, and community partners on a regular basis. You have the ultimate vote. These are your policies. That's my story. I'm sticking to it. Okay. PSUs must adopt the following policies and procedures where continuing: a policy to provide for parental participation in their child's education to improve the parent and teacher cooperation in areas such as homework, school attendance, and discipline that aligns to the parent's guide for student achievement. Let's all, you know, sort of ruminate right now that, like, we are to create a policy that we're supposed to improve cooperation with those things. Okay. This is an overlay of the existing statutory framework as far as school attendance goes, where if you don't send your kid to school, you can go to jail. Not that truancy actually gets litigated anymore, but this is an additional overlay. Additionally, discipline. We have an additional overlay of how parents are to cooperate with discipline. Well, we have state statutes that dictate how your discipline has to be done. So, cooperation is more along the lines of understanding and explaining to parents in a way they can understand how your rules work. I think that's where your student guidebooks come into play. The thing that parents get and the thing that's posted on your website about what gets you what number of days or what punishment has to be very clear. I will say one of the benefits you have is you have a very, very well thought out code of student conduct that is easily accessible that people can click on and get to both policies and the rules applicable from school to school, which is really great. But it's a wonderful thing that must be implemented with fidelity. It's wonderful to have a great handbook. It is more important to make sure it's implemented the way it's supposed to be implemented, right?
Right.
So that was in details. Policies are out there. All right. You are to have a policy that requires principals to effectively communicate with parents in a manner in which textbooks are used and implement the school's curricular activities. Here's my comment. Drafting such a policy is easy. But what must principals do to implement? It's a great question. I've seen several different ways to do this. On any time a parent is present, like for a Title I night, for we invite the parents out night, having the curriculum available on a table for parents to look at all times. I've seen schools that have put it out in the front office on a table so that anytime a parent wants to walk in to check in a kid in or out of school, they can pick up the curriculum because it's right there. Problem is, in a high school setting, that's incredibly difficult because you have so much curriculum. So I think it's grade level specific or grade span specific. But the comment of okay, we can implement this policy, but the accessibility issue is nobody's hid curriculum from parents. But the idea is to make it easier for them to get their hands on, whether that means having digital versions you can send to them, or if that means making copies for them, or maybe giving them access to particular pieces of the curriculum to read at home. Now, one of the things that's always been really easy, at least going back, is like, we're reading The Red Badge of Courage. I'm sending it home with the kids. Parent can read little Johnny's copy of Red Badge of Courage if they really want to see what we're doing in LEA. However, LEA curriculum has changed substantially since people were sending home just hard copy books. They're digital copies. And so it is making sure that you're providing that access to parents for them to have the ability to review that curriculum. Number four, policy to establish a procedure for parents to learn about their child's course of study and the source of any supplemental educational materials, meaning how you went about doing the picking for what's they're learning. The procedure shall include a process for parents to inspect and review all textbook supplementary instruction materials that will be used in the child's classroom. The policy shall be on the school's website and available for in-person review by parents. This is the precursor to book challenges. I'm just going to tell you, this is not anything brand new. This is actually an existing right, but the concept is that it has to be available for inspection and you have to be able to explain the source of where the materials came from. I think one of the ways and one of the reasons this is even in here, because there was a certain amount of latitude given to teachers to go out and find stuff off the internet and to pull it and use it into a classroom. And that freedom, or that element of freedom, has led to questionable sources or questionable homework being given inside of a classroom. Not suggesting here, by the way, but I have seen it in other places where somebody pulled something down off the internet, used it in their classroom, was inherently controversial, was not intended, and their principal had no clue they were using it until they get the call from the parent who says, oh my God, what is this? So, I think that the concept is to eliminate that as much as possible. And I also think group planning, which is very much a PLC-driven content area, is the idea of being able to learn as a community what all we're going to do as a team to teach kids LEA. We're not going to be bringing in, you know, Miss Miller's not going to go out on her own personal island and grab three resources off the internet without talking to her colleagues about it and then use it. Hopefully not. But it's less likely if you're doing PLCs appropriately. PSUs must adopt these policies. Number five, establish a means for parents to object to textbooks, supplemental instructions consistent with those requirements in 115C98. 115C98 has been in existence for a very long time. It takes the standards from what is the United School District versus PICO. That Supreme Court decision memorializes the elements of it in a statute and makes it where the school board has ultimate discretion on what supplementary materials you have inside and textbooks you have in your school district. So this is just a further restatement of you have to have a policy. Guess what? You already have a policy. You have minor revisions that are being made to that policy, but you have that policy already. By the way, you have to have it by federal law anyway. Policy to establish a process for parents to review materials for and consent or withhold consent for participation in reproductive health and safety education consistent with the requirements of 115C81.30. Guess what? For the most part, you have the opt-out already. This is the consent or withhold consent model. And so there's going to be an element of this we're going to talk about in the that we're going to no longer be teaching any reproductive health of any kind in the K-4 context, any sexuality education of any kind in K-4. That's not this. This is just the ability to opt in and opt out. That already exists, by the way. This is a restatement. Your policy already speaks to this, by the way. It further clarifies now, but it already had this in there. To establish a process for parents to learn about the nature and the purpose of clubs or activities offered to their child's school. I think this is interesting, mostly because I think a lot of times we don't give much in the way of credence to the concept of parents wanting to know and understand what all their kids are into as far as extracurricular activities. I want them involved, but like, you're in beta club. What the heck does that mean? I know it's an honor. I know it's awesome. But what do? Right? I think back to my own mother. I was involved in ridiculous number of extracurricular activities in high school, two of which she understood. And that's not because she wasn't involved. It was mostly because, she just didn't know. And I think this is the idea of parents having a better understanding of what extracurriculars their kids are into. Like CTE-driven clubs, Fellowship of Christian Athletes, FCA. Like having that information on your website, that way people can understand it. Oh, thank you. Mm-hmm. Appreciate it. Number eight, a policy to establish procedures governing request for information and appeals. We'll talk about that. That's one that's pretty obvious, and it's new, by the way. Procedures to address parental concern regarding a student's physical and mental health starting at the school principal level and potentially resulting in the parental concern hearing before the state board hearing officer. This is the one that I will tell you. The General Counsel's Office of the State Board of Education has asked for folks like me and my colleagues for comments on, because they're trying to understand how to structure their state board hearing officer process, mostly because it's a new role for the state board to have. Like, it's one thing for them to discipline teachers. It is a fundamentally different thing to have a different fundamental set of facts every single time regarding a parental concern and it being elevated to the role of a state board hearing officer. So, something to consider. Once again, hearing officers in the role of personnel, not uncommon. Hearing officers being used for special education purposes, also not uncommon. Parental concerns, brand new territory. Yes, ma'am.
About that. So would that look like, you know, in our district, if somebody were to have a concern, to take it to the principal, they don't get their answer, they can take it to their director, and then the superintendent, and then they can finally appeal to the board.
Yep.
So this would be appealed to their local board of education.
And then after that,
they get the state board hearing officer?
Yes, but it has to be done within 30 days. Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, from complaint to, if it's not resolved at the local level in 30 days, they have a right to go to the state board hearing officer.
I mean, I understand it should be resolved at the local level.
It's not always that easy.
But in all reality, it doesn't happen that way.
It's not always that easy. It's hard enough to try to schedule a hearing for an elected board or a panel of the board 3 weeks out.
Because oftentimes they just do it when they're already going to the meeting.
Bingo. And even the boards like you, who are dedicated meeting 2 times a month, that's only 2 opportunities. And it's easy for a window to pass where a complaint comes in, and for whatever reason, your meetings are scheduled in such a way that time period just lapses between point A and point B. So this is going to be interesting. Number 10, procedures to provide notifications for parents for 5 specific issues related to their students' physical and mental health. Procedures under point 10 shall include the requirements for school personnel to do one or both of the following. Encourage a child to discuss issues related to the child's well-being with his or her parent, and or facilitate discussion of the issue with the child's parent. I don't think either of these are foreign concepts, by the way. I think we over-communicate with parents, not under-communicate with parents. I think this is pushing back at what I believe is a national narrative about school districts hiding things from parents. North Carolina, as a general rule, has not really, you know, in my experience, been a place where you would conceal anything about a kid from their parent. I think, generally speaking, my experience is that we communicate with parents first, and we over-communicate with them. That's been the complaint I've got. Not necessarily that you didn't share a bit of information with me. So, there are places that's not the case. All right, let's jump into training of teachers. When we talk about places where teachers are probably gonna need training, we're talking about names and pronouns, encouraging students to talk to their parents about sensitive matters, prohibitions on and discouraging sort of that engagement. The concept being is that if you're going to have that conversation about your name and pronouns, I, as the representative of the state or the local government, as your teacher, that's not my role. You talk to your mom and dad about that. Better yet, you talk to the counselor, and the counselor calls your mom and dad, and y'all can have a 3-way conversation about it. But at the end of the day, we don't need, and the concept here, to have teachers engaging in mental health training. That's not their job. It's not their role. Their role is to educate. That's what this is after. Teachers' well-intentioned inquiries that might be considered protected information surveys. That's, you know, an interesting take that I heard from one of my colleagues. It was, you know, whenever a teacher is giving unsolicited questions to kids and getting information about them that isn't vetted through their principal, that could be considered protected information surveys, potentially. We'll see how that actually plays out, but that's one concept. A prohibition on soliciting or arranging health care for minors without parental consent. This is huge. I think this is well-established law that you do not go around arranging medical care for kids, especially without making sure their parents consent to it. But it is very much a more of a thou shalt not. And so I think one of the things Dr. Corcoran pointed out to me before getting here, or before this started, was that you have your health clinics where the parents already consent up front to receive care. And so those parents are actually already going to be privy to that information because they've already consented to that information. They would receive it anyway. That sort of short circuits this issue in a lot of ways, is the affirmative consent. How to respond to student questions regarding sexuality in K-4. I will tell you as a general rule, the answer is talk to your parents. That is the safest answer for school folks to be giving. I think the General Assembly has made it perfectly clear what the expectation is. And I think in the K-4 context, it's if you're having those questions, talk to your mom and dad. The first set of parental rights, not school specific. Parent is defined as the person who has legal custody of the child, including a natural parent, adoptive parent, or legal guardian. It does not seem to apply to a person who stands in loco parentis, but does not have formal legal status. A lot of times, we as a school district do not have any kind of option about how or what the status of the relationship of the person enrolling the child is in school. Like, as long as they sign an affidavit authorizing enrollment, we have this interesting issue that's going to manifest itself, where we have an affidavit to enroll a kid, but as far as legal custody goes, we are in a gray area because we don't have a court order, we don't have a document, we don't have something that makes them the legal guardian. We have something that gives them the ability to make educational decisions, but that's not the same thing as a parent under this definition. And so the rights, as far as this goes, would still lie with the person who has legal custody. Also, by the way, this term was specifically picked because in the family law world, legal custody is a big, I don't want to say boogeyman, but it's one that gets thrown around a lot in family court because legal custody is, frankly speaking, one of those terms that determines what sort of access one has to their child versus physical custody. So, legal custody can oftentimes say, okay, you both have legal custody, but physical custody of the child goes with mom. So if you have a situation where a father or a mother remain to have legal custody, despite not having physical custody of a child, or even being present in their lives, they would still have rights under the Parents' Bill of Rights. I would also argue they still have rights under the federal law, under FERPA, but that's a different conversation. I'm not talking about FERPA today. So, let's start with these Bill of Rights. To direct the education and care of their child. This is a restatement of a constitutional principle we have all known for a very long time. This is not news, but it is the very first one, and I think it's the very first one for a reason. They're trying to make a point. To direct the upbringing and moral or religious training of his or her child. Also, restatement of existing right. There's case law on this point. Nothing particularly new. Number three, to enroll their child in a public or non-public school or in any school, choice options available to the parent. Already an existing right. To access to review educational records of their child as authorized under FERPA, existing right. Number five, to make health care decisions for his or her child unless otherwise provided by law. I will say that is primarily a restatement Number six, to access and review all medical records of his or her child authorized by HIPAA, except as follows. If an authorized investigator requests that information not be released to the parent because the parent is the subject of investigation of a crime committed against the child or abuse and neglect complaint. That's the one we're going to run into, guys, is that we don't release HIPAA records. But guess what? Good news is we won't be in possession of those records, more likely than not, in this district. Your health department or whoever's running your health clinic is going to be in possession of those. Because I will tell you this, when someone asks for education records and you're running a clinic that's owned and operated by your local DHHS, those aren't your records. They're theirs. And they fall under a whole different set of laws, which is HIPAA. And HIPAA protects those. But in addition to DHHS has its own big tent, and they conduct the investigations regarding whether or not there needs to be an investigation for abuse. Now, you have a reporting requirement, right? Like if we see something, we say something. And that's a requirement. But in all honesty, what they're saying is unless that's the reason or there's some otherwise provided by law, you're turning over any medical records you have to the parent. I don't necessarily know that this is new, but it is something to point out. This is a brand spanking new shiny right. To prohibit the creation, sharing, or storage of biometric scan of his or her child without the parent's prior written consent, except as authorized, pursuant to a court order or otherwise required by law for criminal investigations. There are two exceptions that were created in the budget bill when the biometric scan occurs in a public place with no expectation of privacy or when used solely for security or surveillance of buildings or grounds or school transportation. What do you think we're talking about there? Metal detectors. So the idea being that this is a brand spanking new shiny right. Now, I don't necessarily know how many biometric scans you guys have going on as a general rule. Not that many. I think you do wind people down when they come into buildings. I think you wind them down before they come into certain places. But honestly, the biometric scan is a very interesting concept. I don't know if many school districts in the state of North Carolina have the equipment to do a biometric scan. So, but if you're going to do one, now there have been some interesting questions. Do yearbook photos qualify? I think that's an interesting thought. I don't think so. What are the current uses of biometric scan? No idea. But we'll see how that plays out. Number eight. Prohibits the creation, sharing, or storage of a child's blood or DNA without the parent's consent or except as otherwise authorized by a court order. Interesting thought. Random drug test for participation in athletics. That's definitely getting kids' DNA. Nope. Everybody okay? The fact that the test might be permitted under the 14th Amendment does not mean that it will be permitted by this statute. So, interesting thought. We will see how this is interpreted. But it may just mean that you have to get a parent's consent before you do any sort of random drug testing. So how random is your drug testing going to be in athletics? Just a thought. Number nine.
We're not doing drug tests anymore.
No, you're not. And I would tell you not to. But if you were, I would tell you stop, generally speaking.
So, this means A school is doing it somewhere.
Yes. There are schools that do random drug testing for student athletes. Not your problem.
Right. That's good.
That is not something you do. But if you were doing it, it would be an issue. But it's not. All right, number nine, to prohibit the creation by the state, including PSUs, of a video or voice recording of his or her child without a parent's prior written consent, except as follows. during or part of a court proceeding. As part of an investigation under the criminal statutes, when the recording will be used solely for the following purposes: safety demonstration, an academic or extracurricular activity, classroom instruction, photo identification card, security or surveillance in buildings, grounds, or school transportation. I couldn't think of any circumstances that aren't covered by these exceptions. I think it takes care of most of those issues. If you guys can think of something, let me know. But I think generally speaking, the video recording is more common in school than voice recordings. Voice recordings are more often, the few places you'll see those are school buses, or if a teacher pops out their phone and decides to take videos of kids doing little presentations and shares them with mommy or daddy singing a particular song. You know, and once again, I think you could argue that's classroom instruction, and frankly speaking, I'm not really worried about that as much. I do think what this is answering is there were several instances of parents throughout the state of North Carolina and nationally taking videos or pictures of kids, posting them on Facebook without parents' consent, which is dumb, and those people already violated the law and already lost their jobs, because guess what? You can't do that. But that's one of the things that this was aimed at. Number 10, to promptly notify an employee if an employee of the state suspects that a criminal offense has been committed against his or her child, unless the incident was first been reported to law enforcement or the child county child welfare agency, and notification of the parent would impede the investigation. This is a huge expansion of the notice requirement. It is criminal offenses committed anywhere, not just on campus. And it's all criminal offenses, not just reportable criminal offenses under 288G that are considered serious offenses. So guess what? You're going to have a lot of over-reporting to your SROs and a lot of over-reporting to parents. Anytime there's anything that remotely looks like a criminal offense. And I think that was the intent. I think it was meant to over-report. I think this is the product of more than one instance where school officials, whether it was a custodian or an assistant coach, knew something and didn't say something, and a perpetrator was allowed to continue to operate in the sphere harming children for a period of years because they did not feel an obligation, because they didn't sense anything, was very serious. I do believe that's the intent. How are we doing on top? Let's speed up a little bit. 10 enumerated parents' rights. Do not authorize a parent to engage in unlawful conduct, abuse, or neglect, nor do they prohibit a school official or employee from acting in his or her capacity within a reasonable and prudent scope of their authority, or a court from acting within a reasonable and prudent scope of its authority. So, once again, we had a huge restatement of a whole bunch of rights. There's only a few new ones. The idea is nothing in here should impact a public school official or an employee from going about doing the job or the rights that they already have in the scope of what they have to do. It's probably going to change the way they do it, but it doesn't change the fact they have to do their job. That's what this says. Second set of parental rights. These are school specific. And this has the parent, as defined in part two, is as a person who has legal custody of a child, including natural parent, adopted parent, or legal guardian. This presumably would include DSS if awarded legal custody. Interesting point. School personnel is defined as all employees of a public school unit, whether full-time or part-time, and independent contractors and their employees if they carry out duties customarily performed by school personnel and have significant access to children. I am thinking about contractors who perform services for special ed kids. I'm thinking of contractors who are brought in to perform any level of service for your students. So that's the definition. It is the definition of school personnel is exceptionally broader than you would typically think. Parents have legal rights with regards to their child's education, including the right to consent or withhold consent, participation in reproductive health and safety education. This is an existing right. The right to seek a legal or religious exemption from immunization requirements, already in there. The right to review statewide standardized assessment results as part of the state report card. We're going to classify this as a new right, but the information is widely available. Number four, the right to request an evaluation of your child for academic or intellectually gifted program or identification of a student with a disability, an existing right. The right to inspect or purchase public school unit textbooks or other supplementary instructional materials, existing right. The right to access information related to the unit's policies for promotion or retention, including high school graduation requirements. Once again, we have gotten to number seven before we get to something that I would consider new. The right to receive their students' report cards on a regular basis that clearly depict and grade the student's academic performance in each course or class. This is considered a new right. It's in theory, it has a conflict with 47, which gives boards full power to determine the kinds of reports required to be made by teachers. But in the event of conflict, this provision governs. So whatever you do as far as making the report cards, they have to be in compliance with this standard. It's not particularly hard, but an accurate picture of how a kid's doing. Number eight, the right to access information related to state public education system, state standards, report card requirements, academic attendance, and textbook requirements. Once again, new right. However, all this stuff is easily accessible if you reach out to DPI. Most of it's on their website, no matter how dated it looks. Like, for example, the guidebook for your social media or for your media centers. The guidelines are from 2005. They're rewriting them right now, but everything references back to 2005. So, is what it is. Number nine, the right to participate in the parent-teacher organization. It's an existing right. The right to opt into certain data collection for their child as part of part five of this article, protected information surveys in Article 29 of this chapter. That is the PPRA, which is an amendment to FERPA, which the second half of this already exists. But this is what is going to get very interesting, is what constitutes a protected information survey, and as opposed to an opt-out, which is what most school districts have been doing, is, hey, if you want to participate in the survey, you opt out. Now we're going to have to do what's those an opt-in, which is, if you want to participate in the survey, you need to click on the link and go to the survey, as opposed to a general participation. So, number 11, the right of students to participate in protected student information surveys only with parental consent. Duh, we just learned about that. The right to review all available records of materials their child has borrowed from the school library. Now you may say, why does that have to be in there? Once again, I think this is the birth of book challenges. I think this is the reason this is in here. If you would have asked me yesterday, 2 years ago, 10 years ago, whether or not the list of books a kid checks out from the school library is an education record of that child, I would have said uniformly, absolutely yes. There's no reason a parent shouldn't be able to have access to that list. However, now we have new focus in that area. There's a new interest. Therefore, it's a restatement. Parents' legal rights to their child's education public school units shall allow parents to exercise all 12 rights and make rights available to parents electronically or by displaying the information on the PSU's website. Therefore, you have to have it and you have to make it accessible. Yeah. Number five, the Parents' Guide to Student Achievement. Public school units shall provide parents and students and school personnel with a parent's guide for academic achievement. Budget bill for 23-24, no later than the first day of school occurring after January 1, 2024. I want y'all to let that sink in for a second. The parent's guide shall include a minimum of the SBOE's requirements. Shall include the policies developed, ones you guys are going to vote on in December. It be understandable for students and parents, provide in writing to parents, and be discussed at the beginning of each school year in meetings with students, parents, and teachers. The SBE is to develop minimum requirements for public school units for the Parents' Guide to Student Achievement, 14 minimum requirements as specified in the statute. The State Board of Education shall update the minimum requirements annually and provide those requirements to the PSUs by no later than May 1. Budget bill did not advance the SBE's deadline.
Can I ask you a quick question about
yes, ma'am.
Prior? The one that says budget bill for 23-24 no later than the first day of school occurring. And this is just me not understanding. So does that mean for this school year, the first day back in June after
yes.
the holiday?
Yes.
It has to be.
Yes.
Okay. I just want to be sure.
That's you are reading and understanding perfectly. If you thought that the budget bill was giving you a little bit more time, when they said little, they meant little. And so this is the minimum requirements, right? Like you're trying to, the more developed version of this will probably be taking place in the beginning of next school year, but you have to have something up and running. So, lots of fuss. Yep. Implementation issues. This is the reason it's in yellow, because of the timeline. Some of the requirements apply generally to all parents, while others appear to be individualized teachers' qualifications, including licensure status, child's assessment results, report cards, and progress reports. How best to present the different components generally and individually? So you're gonna have those things that are specific, like a teacher's credentials, having those available if a parent asks for those versus, here's the list of the rights that you have to have posted on the website. So one of those is a individual right for that kid in that classroom. Their parent has a right to understand what licensure that teacher has and their qualifications versus putting that out there for public consumption. Now, I'll tell you, generally speaking, it's relatively easy to be able to distinguish on the list. The implementation of it is where it's going to come into play and how you go about providing that information. Historically, if a parent wanted to know about the certifications of a teacher, and it was their child's teacher, they would simply just email the principal. Principal would respond and provide the information. That's the way it would be done. Or if they didn't feel comfortable doing that, they would kick it to Mr. Richardson's office. Mr. Richardson's office would communicate, this licensure, this level of education, this number of degrees, whatever. Nobody's hiding the football here, but that's what would happen. Lots of decisions and discretion to include in how to organize, how much depth and how much detail, okay? Because when you start talking about, a teacher's qualifications, what does that mean? Does that mean, what their undergraduate degree is in? What status are they in the licensure or certification program that they're currently in? Where are they in the process? Are they on a limited learner's permit, meaning a first year, 1 year teacher to get into an apprenticeship program? Like, how much of that detail. But licensure status is very much one of the things that has to be presented. But in addition to that, like, what other things do you have to say? Consider how the parent's guide will be communicated at the beginning of each school year. The statute requires meetings with students, parents, and teachers, which is interesting because it doesn't simply require meetings with just parents. And how are you to explain this to kids in the kindergarten, first or second grade variety? And exactly what do you say to them? So that's it's an interesting thought. Okay, before we get to the next heavy topic, any questions at this juncture? Okay, I'm trying to be cognizant of time. Number six, age-appropriate instruction for grades K through four. Instruction on gender identity, sexual activity, or sexuality shall not be included in the curriculum provided in grades kindergarten through fourth grade, regardless of whether the information is provided by school personnel or third parties. Period. Hard stop. For purposes of this section, curriculum includes the standard course of study and supplement and support materials, locally developed curriculum, supplemental instruction, and textbooks and other supplemental materials, but does not include responses to student-initiated questions. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is their minimum. Right? I mean, this is the, could we not change that grade level? Could we not say we're not
You could do it.
About?
You could expand this. I will say that gender identity, sexual activity, and sexuality, it is going to be hard to have a conversation about reproduction as required by your standard course of study for health in ninth grade without. Now, that's an opt-out area, by the way, and that's a whole other issue that we're going to get into. But if you're going to put a straight ban on it, because this is a ban, this is shall not,
right?
Not an opt-in or opt-out.
But shouldn't be talking about it.
Well, yeah. Well, no. What I'm thinking about is sexual activity, right? Like, sexual activity is a conversation in your reproduction.
Sure.
In your health class in ninth grade, I believe. No. Who's got ninth grade?
Ninth grade.
It's ninth grade?
Yeah, but okay. You also have eighth graders and middle school students that have the conversation.
It's a middle school issue too. So but there's already an opt out for it, right?
Right, opt out right now.
Okay. But you know, this is a straight ban, right? This is thou shalt not talk about it in these grade levels. Now, what's interesting to me is that there's somebody out there actually talking about this in these grade levels. That's sort of the more shocking thing to my conscience.
May I ask a question?
You can ask as many. Yes, ma'am.
So I noticed in the packet there were parts, and maybe it's just a different area. I'm not quite sure. But anyway, there's reference to not talking about sexuality and all that up through fourth grade in some sections, and then other sections it's up through sixth grade.
Yes.
So
that I think has more to do with either existing policy or revisions to your existing policy based on recommendations to the school board association. I'll tell you right now that the only hard cap in the statute is fourth grade.
But if we wanted to
if you wanted to increase, I mean, that,
make it sixth.
That's y'all's discretion. Okay. Y'all can do, once again, you can do whatever you'd like as far as that goes, as long as you hit that minimum, as y'all said, fourth grade is minimum. If you want to raise that to sixth, that is purely up to y'all in your discretion. I would say make sure that's an informed conversation with your curriculum folks before you start making that decision. But as far as permissibility, yeah, legally you can do that.
So we're just sort of writing on these policies in the sampling because they have to take effect by January.
Yes, sir.
So we're not going to be having those conversations. Or is this it?
If you would like to have that conversation now, or if you want to...
Well, I mean, we're only halfway through your slideshow, so...
We can stop my slideshow right now. This is the policy conversation is far more important in my mind.
And when these changes occur, we have to have a reading, right?
When we make
changes to these policies, we have to have a reading.
If it is a policy and you make a recommendation for a revision, the board policy committee can review it, but it can be approved as a change
without a
first reading is only something that is needed.
I understand, but I thought we had to give it some time for a reading.
So there's not a specific amount of time that we have to allow for a rating. We just have to have the rating.
I haven't ever been told the specific time, but we have typically always given a month for the public.
And that's what I'm saying. And unless we make those recommendations now, we won't have it.
Yeah, are they on the agenda for tonight? If you want
they
to
are.
Add,
they,
yeah.
I think then
tonight would be the conversation.
We have it during the board meeting.
Yes, ma'am. During the regular board meeting, not the special.
Now, I'm sorry. I'm special.
Sure.
They're on this document, not for the regular board meeting.
However, now's the time. Now's the time, but also if you want to add it, it's a regular meeting, you can add it.
Can amend the agenda?
You certainly can.
We can amend the agenda.
You can amend the agenda to add these policies information if you so please.
So I have a question then, I guess for Dr. Corcoran. If we were to change that from K-4 to K-6, because on policy 3540, it says instruction on gender identity, sexual activity, or sexuality shall not be included in the curriculum provided in grades K through 6. So what I'm saying is that I think we need to be consistent.
Yeah.
One across the board.
And yeah. So
set it at 6.
Set it at 6.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That would be...
I agree to that. I think
I would
we should.
Agree to that too. Yeah. But I do want to be clear. I know that in... And Dr. Corcoran, is it in, or Dr. Perkins, I'm not sure which one of you I need to ask. In our, I know that there are some classes that parents, I can't remember if they opt into or opt out of, where they start talking to kids about, and we've heard parents for years talk about the sex education classes, but really what they're talking to the kids about is just about how their bodies are going to start changing and, you know, they sort of inform the kids that they need to be taking a bath every day and wear deodorant.
We typically offer in fourth and fifth grade puberty education, which is what you are describing. Very much about hygiene, you know, just some changes to your body and notice what's happening to your body so you can make them, you know, clean yourself, make sure you're clean, those sorts of things. And also just things like, how to talk to your parents and ask your parents. We have not planned to teach puberty K-4 because of the new policy, but we have planned to continue with our fifth grade students unless that is something that the board decides we would not want
so
to
if,
do.
So if we were to say that this applies for K-6, my question is does that prohibit the puberty class? But we shouldn't be talking about gender identity,
we do not talk
sexual
about
activity,
identity.
Or sexuality in a puberty class.
But none of those
we really should
hang
on with that at all.
Yeah.
So it would not impact our puberty education class.
Again, if you said you want to be consistent, then that would be the board's discretion as to how you'd like to do that. We are not talking about any of those things.
Okay.
However, because K-4 was already outlined, we just determined it would be in our best interest just not to teach the puberty education of fourth grade moving forward based on this language.
Yeah.
Just because
Why teach anything?
It says K-4.
Yeah. So,
okay. So here would be my recommendation. I think you're on to something, and I think you set the floor. If you want to set the floor at 6th, and what you're hearing from staff is it shouldn't impact your puberty class, mm-hmm. I think you set it at 6th. That's what I think. Because, I mean, if for whatever reason there's an exploration done of the curriculum and you need to make a further exception to that at a later time, you can certainly do that. But I doubt that you will. I doubt that you'll find that issue. But for whatever reason, if you want to go ahead and set your floor at the 6th grade and set it at the 6th grade, that would be my thinking.
And may I share that before we ever teach puberty education, we offer up to the parents and have a parent night. We share everything that we plan mm-hmm. to teach with the parents. We invite them to a title meeting. That's part of like a small little session that if 4th grade parents want to attend, they can. And then they are able to see exactly what the PowerPoint. We don't, there's all full transparency with those PowerPoints. There's yeah. nothing that we cover that parents are not privileged to see.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
And that brings me to another point. And I know we talk about, we mentioned Title I throughout our policies, and we specifically state that it's our Title I schools that have to do certain things, right? And when it comes to parent information. And I think that's been a sticking point for me. I mean, I know we've got more schools that are Title I now, but I think we should be giving this information to parents, whether it's a Title I school or not. And I think we do.
We do.
But I don't think, but we don't, we're not consistent in putting that in our policies. And I don't want for future reference for it to be a wiggle room of space.
Sure.
You know?
Okay, so how do we make this to apply? How do we amend this policy in this format?
I think right now you've provided the direction to revise the policy, and then before you see it in December, it'll be revised.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Does everybody agree?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean,
that would be discussed at the board meeting? In other words, you're gonna make that discussion, you're gonna have that discussion at the regular board meeting tonight, or you're saying?
I think they've given the direction right now.
Okay.
The direction. What they want to see, because I mean, this is a special board meeting to talk about it. So I figure like they can give us direction right now on the policies, and then.
And I'm sorry, I just didn't hear what they finally wanted to.
Six. Yes, ma'am.
And then we'll also look at the policy to make sure that it's consistent, that uh-huh. these meetings are required for all schools.
Yep. Thank you for picking that up. Okay.
Sounds good.
I've got approximately 15 minutes. continued thoughts. These provisions are significant. They give rise to uncertainty or criticism, what teachers may or may not say. You know, these are questions we essentially just vetted. Notification to parents in general. You have to notify them of the parental rights. The PSU shall make the rights contained in this section available to the parents electronically or displayed the information on the website of public school unit, meaning got to be able to click on it and read it. Parents guide for student achievement. PSUs must provide to parents, students, and school personnel a parent guide for student achievement, first day back after January 2023-2024. Parents' guide must include the SBE requirements. I already talked about that. healthcare services at the beginning of the school year. Parents shall be given notice of each healthcare service offered by his or her child's school and a means for the parent to provide consent for any specific service. Made sense? Any questions about that? Okay. At the beginning of each school year, parents shall be notified of procedures to exercise parental remedies. This is the, if you've got a concern, here's how you go about addressing that concern, making sure they're informed of the process. Prior, this is grades K through 3, well-being questionnaire or health screening form. Prior to the administration of students and K through three parents shall be notified of a copy of any student well-being questionnaire or health screening form and means for the parent to consent to use of the questionnaire or form for his or her child. This is where the devil is in the details. If there's some sort of questionnaire or form about a child, the parent has the ability to opt out, essentially, and they have an ability to see it in advance. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Protected information surveys. This is a area of ambiguity, let's say that. At least 10 days prior to the administration of a protected information survey, a PSU shall make available to parents and adult students the process for providing consent to participate in the survey and a full text of the protected information survey. So you can't just go off half-cocked and just give them a survey. You got to give them a copy of it at least 10 days in advance. The PSU shall provide opportunities for review of information both electronically and in person. So it's not an or, it's an and. You got to have it digitally and you got to have it in person. Changes in services or monitoring related to health and well-being. Parents must be given notice of changes in services or monitoring related to his or her child's mental, emotional, or physical health or well-being and the school's ability to provide a safe and supportive learning environment for that child. What the heck does all that mean? It's a great question. I think there are certain things that are obvious. If your child has an exceptionality and they have a behavior improvement plan and you have a communication log about whether or not Johnny had a good day or a bad day and he was hitting or spitting or kicking, that's going to be able to provide some of that notification. However, if you have a situation where a kid is beginning to become more extrovert or more introverted over a period of days to the point at which he does not want to communicate with his classmates, instead of addressing that at the school level, this seems to create an obligation where that communication has to go home to mom and dad and say, hey, by the way, we have noticed that Johnny is pulled himself back, does not want to engage with his peers, is very, you know, introverted where he was previously very extroverted. I want to bring this to your attention. There's a whole bunch of gray area of how this is actually going to be implemented and what constitutes in the monitoring of the mental, emotional, or physical health or well-being. Like that's huge. That is so huge because some of that is aging, right? but also some of that can be misconstrued or misinterpreted. So at what point this is going to lead to the over-communication. And I think that, once again, I think that was the intent. I think the intent was to inundate parents with information about what's going on with their kid as opposed to the alternative, which was noticing things and not saying anything. So it's unclear to me how the clause and the school's ability to provide a safe and supportive learning environment fits in. Because the first thing I see is you have to provide notice. You have to tell them. Otherwise, I think the second part may be aimed at your child find obligations. Like, hey, by the way, if you notice that this kid is demonstrating something that could potentially be a disability, therefore it is your obligation to provide that safe learning space for them. This is sort of another avenue of telling the school, hey, you got to go do it. That's what I think. We'll see what it actually means. Because somebody could, I mean, there's so many ways this could go sideways. Change in name or pronoun. Parents must be given notice of any changes in name or pronoun used by a child in school records or by school personnel.
Didn't it also say nicknames?
Mm-hmm.
Somewhere.
Yeah.
Even
yeah.
Yeah.
Covered nicknames.
Yeah.
We have to.
So, name. Name includes nickname. So, it's very interesting.
Can I ask a question? If a parent proactively says, like in my case, I'm a great example,
sure,
you can call him Sean. Would that satisfy that if they at first day of school
I think so. I've got a similar situation. Mm-hmm. My middle son is named Jack, or you know, his name's John, but he goes by Jack. He's gone by Jack his entire life. I would think that's completely reasonable and, you know, sort of expected. What I think this board and everybody sort of understand what this is aimed at. This is aimed at, you know, a teacher, you know, willing to go by changing somebody's name in a school setting without letting mom and dad know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what this mm-hmm. is aimed at. And I don't think you're going to get many issues of, you know, James, whose middle name is Ryan, now wants to go by Ryan, and I'm pissed about it. Like, you're not going to run into that. You're just not. I mean, maybe.
And I'm really asking for our teachers who are just, absolutely, I think they just want some clarity on this.
Absolutely. And I mean, I really do think that this is aimed at whenever you are doing a pronoun change. Somebody going from he or she to they or them, something like that. And I would also argue that it seems to me that you must notify the parents prior to any change taking place. I think that's the point. I think telling them contemporaneously before you fundamentally change what you're calling your kid is really important. Because I think as schools, as arms of the government, which we forget that we are, by the way, we forget that we are arms of the government, we are disregarding the wishes of the parents if we decide to call somebody by some name or pronoun that mom and dad did not wish. Does providing notice to parent violate the child's rights? I would say no. I think under FERPA, it's a clear no. Under Title IX, don't think so. The child's constitutional right to privacy does not exist. There is one court out there in California that has laid down this ambiguous point. I will tell you that it has not stood up the test of time anyplace else. Everywhere else in the United States of America, except for California, parents still possess their kids' rights and get to make decisions, and the only way that you can sign a settlement over a minor child is if mommy and daddy are involved. So, last time I checked, mom and dad are still, you know, the purveyors of children. Does the Parents Bill of Rights give parents a veto power over a proposed name change? Not specifically. I will tell you that my advice to your teachers and to your administrators is you listen to what mommy and daddy have to say. If they say, no, I do not want you to call Jim Sue, I want you to call him Jim. Darn it, you better listen. Not your kid. You know, this is a sparse area of case law. I think it's always a safer space to be in, to be on the same side of the V as a parent as opposed to opposed, generally speaking. But if a parent and a kid come to you together and say, hi, I'm parent and kid, and he has been Jim for the past 5 years, I want him to go by Sue now, and you need to call him Sue, the answer is, yes, ma'am, I will call him Sue, because you're the parent, and you tell me what to identify your kid as. That's not my job as the government. My government job is not to tell you what to call your kid. I will do what you tell me to. What if school officials think notifying parents puts the child at harm? I think this is one of those situations where you engage in what schools do all the time, which is engaging the parent in civilized conversation about the issue. And if you really believe the child is at risk of harm, you do what your reporting requirement requires you to, and you engage with DSS. Notice of any crimes committed against a child, parents' right to be promptly notified. Once again, this is huge. This is going to be really like inundated with notification requirements. What about a minor assault or battery, offensive touching, which is not sexual and does not require result in an injury? Technically, it's a criminal offense, but it's not a mandatory report to law enforcement and rarely would be charged. There are a lot of students on student minor batteries every single day. Every unwanted touching. I think particularly if my brother-in-law who, whenever he was in third grade, another kid licked the back of his neck continuously, which grossed him out. And eventually he pushed the kid, and the teacher asked him why he pushed the kid. He said, because he kept licking his neck. And so that's an offensive touching. So at what point do we have to share that information with a parent? I think there's a level of reason that's going to get applied to this that right now it's not there because it's not anticipated. But once again, we are in the over-notifying versus under-notifying camp right now. Prior to the administration of the K-3, we've already talked about this one. No student shall be permitted to participate in a protected information survey without prior written or electronic consent of the parent. What is a protected information survey? A survey, analysis, or evaluation that reveals information concerning the following: political affiliations or beliefs of the student or the student's parent, mental or psychological problems of the student or the student's family, sex behaviors or attitudes, illegal, antisocial, or self-incriminating or demeaning behavior, critical reprisals of other individuals with whom respondents have close family relationships, legally recognized, privileged, or analogous relationships such as lawyers, physicians, and ministers, religious practices, affiliations, or beliefs of the student or the student's parent, income other than those required by law for determining the eligibility to participate in a program or receiving financial assistance under such program. We're thinking about the ability to qualify for free and reduced price lunch. That's exactly where that phrase was put in there. But so that's where the opt-in for protected information surveys and what's going to qualify as protected information survey is going to be a very interesting field that somebody's going to get sued over. And so my advice is to be very broad in the interpretation and limiting of those questions. The opportunity for a parent to review those surveys in advance, critically important. I don't think that's news, by the way. I think the 10-day requirement is interesting because it provides this opportunity for parents to engage in the ability to potentially rewrite questions for or decide whether or not they're going to participate. So, number 10. Gives parents the right to request information, provides an appeal process up to the BOE. The board has to adopt a policy and procedures. You have one of those in front of you. The parent's right to request information and local appeal process applies to the following areas: priority of parent involvement in schools, parents' legal rights to a child's legal education, the parent's guide for student achievement, the public school policies to increase parent involvement, and timelines for parental requests for information. Timelines for responding to a parental request are, this is where it gets complicated, parent must make initial request for information to the principal. Statute sets no limit within which that the parent must make initial request. Okay. Principal shall provide requested information in 10 business days, or 20 if the written notice of an extension. Parent may then request the information from the superintendent. Statute specifies no time limit to appeal to the superintendent. Presumptively, the procedures will impose reasonable appeal time, such as 10 business days. Superintendent will provide a response within 10 business days, okay? A parent may appeal to the local BOE no later than 20 business days after the date of the request to the superintendent. The BOE shall place the appeal on the agenda at the next meeting. This is the first time that by state law, the General Assembly has dictated to you that you shall do something regarding your agenda, by the way. Like, this is the first time. But they're telling you that this, if there's an appeal to you and you have a meeting, it's going on that next agenda, period. meetings. Now, it doesn't prevent you from scheduling it before then, by the way. But if you're going to have the next meeting, better be on the next meeting agenda. Board decision is final, is not subject to judicial review. That's good news. I want anybody who feels led to Google TGFMS. I had to figure out what that meant. Parental consent concern hearings going to the state board. Oh my God, let me finish this up pretty quick. This is a process only applies to part four, which is notifications of student physical or mental health, student support services training, appropriate age-appropriate instructions under K-4, and remedies of parental concerns. If a parental concern is not resolved in 30 days following notification of a principal, the PSU shall provide a statement of the reasons for not resolving the concern. Although not specifically stated in the statute, the PSU statement presumptively should be provided within 30 days. For this process, the 7-day and the 30-day periods probably mean calendar days rather than business days. Just think about that. So if you have a concern dealing with one of these items, it's expedited. Everything's going to move a lot quicker. This was the primacy given to these notifications of a student's physical and mental health, the age-appropriate instruction, and remedies of parent concerns. So they have two tracks. You can track one is to notify the state board of the concern and request a parental concern hearing. Track two is to bring an action against the local school unit seeking declaratory or injunctive relief. This is going to be a fun time because I'm pretty sure that these actions would not be covered on your insurance currently as written. So maybe something we want to bring up to the school board's trust to cover these types of proceedings. Like if somebody sues you while you're trying to address their concern and get declaratory relief, maybe that should be covered. This is great. The public school unit pays the hearing officer even if it's determined that the public school unit did nothing wrong. So you win, you pay. You lose, you pay. So, awesome. The interesting thing about the lawsuit and the claiming monetary damages is this has not existed before. Like, there's a statutory presumption that your actions are correct, and it's a hard burden to overcome. We have now created a mechanism for someone to have a concern, not have it addressed at the local level, and get to a courtroom to have it vetted with the potential to get monetary damages for whatever claimed relief that they allege has occurred. So this is going to be very interesting to see how this actually plays out. I think now is a good time for me to stop. I think if we go any further, I think I'll stop it here.
So can I ask you a quick question?
Yes, ma'am.
Several of us have notes written on our policy
yes.
packets that we were given. When would be a good time for us to ask you about making some of those changes? I mean, I understand we need to pause now. We clearly probably need to pause now.
Yeah.
But when could we go over these questions?
I think we should add an item to the agenda to have those. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
That would be my recommendation.
Me and the agenda. We can do that.
Yeah. She's got a few more slides, and I know I've got stuff written all over my packet, and I'm sure others do too.
Yep.
So, do you want us to make a motion to adjourn?
I think so. To adjourn the special meeting. Yes, ma'am.
Let me get
Let me go ahead and X out of this.
We will adjourn. Can I please have a motion to adjourn?
I make a motion that we adjourn.
Thank you. Is there a second? All in favor say aye.
Aye.